But anyway, so tell me how you think nihilism has a positive aspect to it. Because I've sort of like summed up and labeled all the things I should be afraid of and things I should be guiding towards. And I just sort of labeled a whole bunch. I just put nihilism on a box and threw all these bad things in there. But maybe I've mislabeled it. So,
well, I guess like the... It's not as brutal, I don't think. I think that's more like... I think that has to do more with like the anarchist. You know, anarchists can be brutal. But I think with nihilism, it's like if you take it from like a Buddhist point of view, from my understanding, is that like it's not that things are meaningless and then therefore there are no rules and there's no morality. I think it's deeper than that, really. Like, if you start off with like, I mean, this is a pretty tangly conversation, but like, I think that what people like about it and what they're drawn to it is that they've seen that these big ethical and moral ideas don't function, and that they have to happen on like more of a ground level. And nihilism is as close to a like the lowest ground possible as far as like individuality goes, and like creating your own life and person and individual, because it's like you start off with nothing and then you create meaning in your life from there. Like,
oh, that's interesting. But you're talking about like a starting point then.
Yeah, it's a starting point. It's you know, oftentimes people in a simple way, they talk about like small goals, achieving those, and I think nihilism is like well suited for that. Like, you start off with very like easy conditions for yourself, right? And you build up. There is a certain built-in realism to nihilism. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. I've never heard of nihilism as a starting point, because I've always thought of it as people projecting to the future. Well, it all ends in a big crunch anyway, so who cares?
And yeah, but that's someone that hasn't dealt with their ego. Like, there's an egoism. Like, there's an ego. The thing about ego is that it doesn't function well with certain ideas. And that's what I learned in psychology, is that when you're like egoless, you can deal with human relationships in a more functional way, in a more real way, in a more meaningful way. And you can take on any kind of philosophical concept without an ego. And I feel like it's a more fulfilling concept. And that goes for nihilism as well.
Tell me more about the nihilism as a beginning. Because I think of things in terms of cycles, and if everything kind of ends.
Right.
The thing is, like, with the nihilism that I've vilified is a linear concept.
Right.
It ends and that's it. Everything's dead.
Mm-hmm.
But if it's a cycle, then...
But why is that? See, this is where it comes down to the ego, right? And that I really truly believe it blocks people's ability to understand these things. So like, yeah, you're right. The horizon line for nihilism is like the extinction, the total extinction of things. Is likely to happen. Like, we see timelines now, like with nuclear like waste and everything, that are enormous, right? It's very unlikely, based off of the previous mass extinctions, that human beings will like proliferate beyond a certain point, unless they side up with Elon Musk and like go to space, you know, like, and all of this stuff. But it's not so bleak in a lot of ways, because you have to deal with your death, you know, and that's Buddhism is very much about that. You have your small death, right? And that's like these small ideas of nihilism, of the happy nihilism is a good way to put it, because yeah. If you, that's the whole big thing, is like, we're stuck in this time of, another way to explain it is post-modernity, right? Like, post-modernism has put us in this place where we're like, we really feel like we can't get out of it. Nobody's ever invented a way out of post-modernism. And so nihilism is the natural byproduct of that. And people are trying to do more with it, you know? And understanding that, like, we're finite beings. We're made of so many things, that everything we are, technically, a human being is an assemblage of things. So like, a nihilist approach is, in a sense, is understanding that we're made up of organs and molecules and all of these things that are passing through our body that are beyond us. Like a lot of people are pushing for like these, post-humanist ideas, because they make sense in a world where it feels like it's very bleak, right?
How old are you? No, I'm just...
Yeah, 29, almost 30, January 3rd. I'm a Capricorn.
Very good.
Since we were talking about it.
I just turned 50 in May. I'm a Gemini. And I do notice, like, because the world had... The walls are closing in when I was a kid.
Yeah, right.
And... But they had a long way to go. Now I feel like, you know, I was just trying to buy some damn bitcoins. And you can't unless you have a cell phone. Right. I refuse to have a cell phone because that's a control mechanism. And
right.
It's just like I can't even get onto an exchange without, what's your phone number? It's like, well, we don't take VoIP numbers, you know, like voice over IP. And I'm like, well, how am I going to – there's all these little things, and if you – you look at some of the structures that are going on right now. Are you going to get your COVID vaccine? I'm like, hell no. But they're like, well, you might not have a choice. You know, how are you going to get work? If you're like, these things are terrifying, right? It feels like it's like we're right here. Like, are there any cracks to get out? You know, it's like, take your last breath. The water's, you know.
Right.
Oh, my God. Yeah.
Yeah.
And this is what, I mean, you're almost 30, so you... are a little more tempered, I would guess, but I can't imagine being 15 in this world.
Oh.
Or even a 20-year-old. Sorry?
I teach that. How old? Perspective. I'm 30.
Okay.
Yeah, and the kids get it. They're just like, yeah, the world, we won't have jobs, the robots. Like, they're just, they're nihilistic. Like, they're just like, oh, what's the point? Like, they're just like, the world's a big joke for them, and they just...
How do they manage though? How do they navigate it? Is it
the same way humans always do, like just making it a joke and
And that's nihilism is pretty funny.
Yeah,
you know, like since we're on this topic,
I have big minds that are like, I don't even like they're so intelligent. Like it's really hard for me to like read.
It's the
like
essential
them.
Desk.
Like, yeah.
Right.
Like,
wow.
They're just like, yeah, the world's ending, climate change.
Because you have to realize that like philosophy in like its traditional sense is like it's. Technically like therapeutic, like that's people, if you want to know why people philosophize, it's to allow themselves to feel soothed, right? And
or at least understand what the heck's going
on. And that's exactly it. You feel soothed when you understand something a little bit more, and sometimes you have to push the boundary a little bit farther, and that's why we have so many different schools of philosophy. Wow.
That's interesting. I've never heard of nihilism as a beginning point, and I can see exactly...
Well, this is your beginning point.
It's, well, you know...
as a nihilist.
Well, no, I would never call
myself...
Then again, I have my old labels, and they serve me very well. I don't know if I want to abandon them just yet.
You haven't been outmoded yet, yeah.
Oh, I've been outmoded. I'm way outmoded. I just, I figure, you know, my approach is like, hey, take your mode into the future. My rickety little mode served me perfectly well.
Right.
Yeah. Oh, my God. But I'm actually very optimistic for the future.
Yeah.
Extremely. I think that I don't know if I'll survive to see it.
Right.
It's just so grim. But, I mean, you study Buddhism. I mean, one of the tenets of Buddhism is that you're endless. You know, you don't, you have to do it over and over and over again, you know, and I don't think of it as you have to. It's like, I think it's a choice each time. And the way I understand it, and I've spent a lot of time researching, talking, just learning as much as I can. The structure that I currently hold is that this particular level of reality is really hard. It's a material level, and it's very, you know, things don't change shape and size based on your wishes and whims. It's just, it's hard to survive. There are levels further up where it's much more energetic and much more flexible, and like what you think sort of becomes reality. That takes energy. There's a way of working. And then above that, they skip materialism altogether. But the reason you pick this sucky hard one where time is linear, you can't hop back to yourself yesterday and just slip into that time thing and just we're stuck here is because the lessons, yes, they hurt, but they just make the soul grow so much. It's the point, right? It's the suffering,
right?
And
and arguably like all those layers that you're talking about of like different time periods are all overlapping at one time now, right? Like you were talking about this antiquated table, you know, like I mean, like it's all here.
There's something happening at this table in another time and space that I know about. Let me tell you about this. So I had this...
it's got historicity to it.
Okay, so I had a girlfriend who actually now owns this building.
Yeah. She's...